My name is Patricia Silver. I'm a research associate here at Centro. I have my cheat sheet here, so just to make sure I don't forget to tell you anything. I just want to give you a warm welcome on behalf of our director, Edgardo Melendez, and all of us at the Centro de Estudio Puertoriqueño. I welcome you to this evening's Meet the Author event with author Jorge Duany and distinguished commentators and panelists, Ramon Hernandez and Anthony Stevens-Arroyo. Before introducing them, I want to draw your attention also to the flyers that we have back there, that we have both a calendar, the complete events for this semester, as well as flyers for two events happening next week, Sexuality and Power in Mayra Santos-Febre's work, which is next Monday, and the Puerto Rican Culinary Arts, which is next Wednesday, and the details of location and exact time and so forth is all in the flyers, so please pick those up. I also want to give thanks to Evelyn Rivera and Kai Margarita Ramirez for their hard work and attention to all the details that make this event possible, and to John Bravo DiMarcoli for designing the flyer for this presentation of the book Blurred Borders, and to the media department of Centro for handling the technology needs for the presentation and preservation of this event. I will introduce the author and commentators now all together and then hand the program to them. And following their presentations, we will have some time for questions, open discussion, and there will also are books in the back as well, near where the flyers are. So first, I just want to say it's a special pleasure for me to introduce Jorge Duany, whom I met for the first time, I think, some 15 years ago. He's been to me, as he has been to so many starting scholars, he's been a mentor, advisor, colleague, and friend. And it was a privilege to work with him as co-editor on Centro Journal's special 2010 issue on Puerto Rican Florida. Jorge Duany is acting dean of social sciences and professor of anthropology at the University of Puerto Rico, Rio Piedras, and he previously served as director of the UPR's Department of Sociology and Anthropology and director of the journal Revista de Ciencias Sociales. He has held visiting, teaching, and research appointments at several U.S. universities, including Harvard and the universities of Connecticut, Wisconsin, Florida, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, and the City University of New York. He earned his PhD in Latin American Studies, specializing in anthropology at the University of California, Berkeley. He also holds an MA in social sciences from the University of Chicago and a BA in psychology from Columbia University. He has published extensively on migration, ethnicity, race, nationalism, and transnationalism in the Caribbean and the United States, and serves on the editorial boards of multiple academic journals, including our own Centro Journal of the Center for Puerto Rican Studies. He is a prolific writer and has published countless articles with a list too long to include here. But in addition to his academic scholarship since February 2003, he writes a monthly editorial column for the newspaper El Nuevo Día, and in 2010 received the Bolívar Pagán Prize for Journalism from the Institute of Puerto Rican Literature. Tonight he will introduce us to his latest book, Blurred Borders, Transnational Migration Between the Hispanic Caribbean and the United States, published in 2011. And additional works from Dr. Duany include La Nación en Vaivén, Identidad, Migración y Cultura Popular en Puerto Rico, published in 2010, co-edited How the United States Racializes Latinos, White Hegemony and Its Consequences, The Puerto Rican Nation on the Move, Identities on the Island and in the United States, Cubans in Puerto Rico, Ethnic Economy and Cultural Identity with Jose Covas, El Barrio Gandul, Economía Subterránea, Inmigración Indocumentada en Puerto Rico, and Quisqueya on the Hudson, The Transnational Identity of Dominicans in Washington Heights, from the CUNY Dominican Studies Institute. Our first commentator is Ramon Hernandez. Dr. Hernandez is director of the CUNY Dominican Studies Institute and professor of sociology at the City College of New York. She also serves as doctoral faculty at the Graduate Center of CUNY. Her research and publication interests include the mobility of workers from Latin America and the Caribbean, the socioeconomic conditions of Dominicans in the diaspora, particularly in the United States, and the restructuring of the world economy and its effects on working and poor people. She holds a Master of Philosophy and a PhD from the Department of Sociology at the Graduate School of the City University of New York, as well as an MA in Latin American History, with a minor in Puerto Rican Studies from the Department of Latin American and Caribbean Studies at New York University. She's a member of the editorial board of the Latino Studies Journal and Encyclopedia Latina, History, Culture, Society. She's a trustee of the Sociological Initiative Foundation and the Instituto Global de Altos Estudios en Ciencias Sociales in the Dominican Republic. She's also the vice chair of the Dominican Studies Association and has lectured at numerous universities throughout the US, the Caribbean, and Europe. Dr. Hernandez is the author of The Mobility of Workers Under Advanced Capitalism, Dominican Migration to the United States, published in 2002, and winner of the outstanding academic title from Choice in 2003. As with each of our panelists, her academic credits are too long for me to enumerate, but I will point to two publications in 2011 co-authored with Anthony Stevens Acevedo. Dominican Immigrants, An Update of Dominican Americans, and part of a collection of essays in Multicultural America, An Encyclopedia of the Newest Americans, published by Greenwood Press, and the chapter The Dominican American Family in Ethnic Families in America, Patterns and Variations, published by Prentice Hall. She also deserves special recognition for her role in the academic initiative for the Insular Spanish Caribbean, which is specifically Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Dominican Republic, the focus of the book that we're here to consider tonight. Our second commentator is Anthony Stevens-Arroyo, Professor Emeritus of Puerto Rican and Latino Studies at Brooklyn College and Distinguished Scholar of the City University of New York. He was the first director of the Center for Study of Religion in Society and Culture, academic home of the Peral Study. Among his many credits, I'll begin with recognizing his contribution to Central Journal as a reviewer for the work we are discussing tonight. Widely published both in English and Spanish, he has written more than 50 scholarly articles and authored 10 books, including the four-volume Peral series on religion among Latinos and Latinas. The forthcoming 2012 book, Blessing the Política, co-edited with Carlos Vargas Ramos, also draws on the Peral study. Professor Stevens-Arroyo's 1980 book, Prophets Denied Honor, an anthology on the Hispanic Church in the United States, is considered a landmark of Catholic literature. With his spouse, Ana Maria Diaz Stevens, he authored the award-winning Recognizing the Latino Religious Resurgence in U.S. Religion. His pioneering work on the cosmological world of the Taino peoples of the Caribbean at the time of Columbus, Cave of the Jagua, was issued in a second edition in 2006. His most recent publication was a bilingual edition with the first ever English translation of the 17th century history of Puerto Rico by Canon Diego Torres y Vargas. Professor Stevens-Arroyo has served on numerous boards and made multiple appearances on the news media. In retirement, he has apparently not slowed down at all. He is active in a host of civic organizations in Monroe County, Pennsylvania, where he resides with his wife. So without further ado, I will pass the program to our panelists, and thank you all for being here.
Thank you very much, Patricia, for your very nice presentation. Thank you to Edwin Melendez, who was the one who invited me originally last semester to come here. And I also want to thank Duany Stevens-Arroyo. I want to make sure that I represent
Duany Stevens-Acevedo,
and then we have another colleague, Diaz-Arroyo, and Ramon Hernandez for agreeing to do the comments. Evelyn Collazo, who has put together the whole activity here. So now I think we need to do, or is it going to be projected here or over here? Just here? Okay, fine. So what I'd like to do is to give you a sense of what the book covers, and then give my colleagues a chance to respond and to comment on their views of the main arguments. But basically, what I want to do for this presentation, and it's really the main issue in the book as well, is to talk about the three diasporas from the Hispanic Caribbean, Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Dominican Republic, and to see how each one of them has developed a special kind of relationship to their home countries. In the case of Dominican migration, I think, although Ramona may or may not agree with me on this issue, it has been considered a classic case of transnationalism. And especially our colleague Silvio Torres Allant has argued that actually it's much better to talk about Dominican migration as a diaspora rather than transnationalism. For the purposes of this presentation, and I know this might be confusing at first, I'm going to use the two terms as if they were practically synonymous. I mean diaspora and transnationalism. And then in the case of Cuba, which is typically not talked about in the studies of transnationalism, what I want to argue is that Cuba has developed a special kind of transnationalism that, compared to both the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, it still has some qualities that are shared by the three countries, but the main difference is that it takes place outside the official channels of Cuba-U.S. relationships, and I want to develop that point a little further. And finally, in the case of Puerto Rico, I was struggling with the terms that I want to describe and classify the Puerto Rican diaspora, and also it turns out it's a special case. Also, although every case might be considered special, but I think what distinguishes Puerto Rico from the two other cases is that it's a case of colonial transnationalism. The fact that Puerto Rico is not a nation state, and therefore cannot be called a transnational nation state like the Dominican Republic or Mexico or El Salvador, I think then has to be taken account of, and this is my way of understanding this, although I think it's very much a work in progress. So just to give you some ideas of the magnitude of the diaspora, I collected here what the available data for the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st century, and with the case of Cuba, it's interesting for several reasons, one of them being that Cuba, even before the statistics begin here, even before the 20th century, had a significant migration to the United States after 1868, roughly, with the beginning of the 10 Years' War in Cuba. Then, of course, that migration to the United States decreased significantly after 1930 with a resurgence after 59, and then you can see a couple of patterns there. Since 1959, a significant increase until the 1980s, decrease, and then finally, in the last two decades or so, Cuban migration has experienced a resurgence, and in fact, the largest number of Cubans have migrated since 1989 with the onset of the special period in times of peace, as the Cuban economic crisis has been called. In the case of Puerto Rico, and perhaps before I comment on the main patterns here, I should note that it's very difficult to get statistics on these movements. Several people have published different versions of these statistics, but I don't want to go into the details and not bore you with the technical aspects of it, but just to recognize that it's very difficult to measure migration between the two places. These statistics are based on net passenger movement. And my main point here is that there are two peaks, in the 1950s especially, with almost 500,000 Puerto Ricans who migrated from the island to the mainland. Then again, a significant decrease with a large amount of return migration in the 1970s, and then now, since 1980, we have seen a tremendous increase compared to the earlier decades, although we haven't reached yet the level of mass migration in the 1950s. And finally, the Dominican Republic is a little more straightforward because until 1961, with the assassination of Rafael Núñez Trujillo, there was practically no significant migration to the United States, although, of course, before that date, there were small numbers of Dominicans in the United States. But clearly, every decade since 1960 has increased the level of migration, except for the last decade with a small decrease and roughly about 300,000 legal migrants in the Dominican Republic. Of course, these statistics don't take account of the undocumented migration. So those are the three main movements that I want to speak about. Another way of measuring the size of the migration, and which is actually more reliable because it's based on the census every 10 years, is to look at the proportion of people of Cuban, Dominican, and Puerto Rican origin compared to the total. And here what I did was to add the number of people in the United States with the number of people in their home countries. And basically Puerto Rico stands out because more than half of all people of Puerto Rican origin, including people born in the United States, live in the United States. Cuba and the Dominican Republic represent about 13% in terms of their populations of origin, but still quite significant in all three cases. One of the issues that is taken up in the book, and I just want to mention it from the beginning, is the question of remittances, which are very significant in the case of Cuba and the Dominican Republic, not so much in the case of Puerto Rico, and I might be able to try to explain that paradox of a very large migration, more than 4.6 million people of Puerto Rican origin living in the States, and yet a very modest level of remittances, roughly $350 million per year, according to official sources. But the Dominican Republic here clearly stands out, and it's one of the six or seven major remittance economies in the hemisphere after much larger countries like Mexico, Brazil, and Guatemala. So then, that's sort of a general background of what I want to talk about. The rest of the presentation really focuses on each one of the cases and then trying to make some sense of what the differences between them are. Now, a lot of the images that I use in this presentation have been taken from websites all over the place, and I'm not sure exactly why I took this one, but I think the idea of the mixture of the Dominican peso on the one hand and the U.S. dollar is sort of what strikes me of this image, and also the idea of a transnational nation state, which is the term that I take from the work of Peggy Levitt and Nina Glick-Schiller, which have proposed a threefold comparison of different kinds of states in terms of the relationship with their diasporas. And this is the term that they use and I use in my own work. Now, Quisqueya Heights or Washington Heights here in New York City is probably the most studied of all places where Dominicans have lived, and for good reason, because of the fact that it's a very strong concentration of Dominicans, and also in terms of culture, some of these images suggest the kinds of things that I'm interested in, the politics and the culture, the popular culture, the music, the street expression, and the expression of popular culture in the streets in Washington Heights. And one particular aspect that I'm interested in is this question of naming places like St. Nicholas Avenue after Juan Pablo Duarte, one of the main founders of the Dominican nation. And another very strong image that I found on the internet is the question of how the Virgin of Altagracia, which is a patron saint of the Dominican Republic, has been transplanted to New York City, and now along with the flag and other very important aspects of Dominican culture. And that's something that needs to be studied as well. One of the things that I look at comparatively in the book has to do with the second generation, although most studies have concentrated on the first generation. But for example, the terms that are used to describe people who were born in the United States of Dominican origin, such as Dominican York, which originally at least was a very pejorative term, just like New Yorican, for example, in the case of Puerto Ricans born in the United States, wherever they were born, regardless of people born in New York City or not. And questions of language and identity are paramount in terms of trying to figure out exactly what the second and third generation is going to look at. And in fact, Ramon Hernandez and other colleagues that we have proposed a comparative study of the second generation to look at more clearly exactly what's going on with them. Another aspect of the issue of transnationalism that I'm very interested in has to do with questions of definitions of home. And in this particular image from Washington Heights, llama casa de tu casa, or call home from your home, I think it's whoever invented that phrase, it was right on target. I mean, what is home? Is home Washington Heights or New York City, or is home over there somewhere abroad in the Dominican Republic? And of course, whoever did this was trying to sell their product, and I think it was 67 cents at that point. It's probably much lower right now. So telephone calls, for example, have increased tremendously in the last decade or so. These are official traffic data from the Federal Communications Commission, and as you can see, Dominicans call home a lot. It's reached, the maximum level was 300 million calls per year, and decreasing a little bit after that, but still quite sizable. And again, comparing the Dominican Republic as a market for telephone calls, it's one of the most important ones for the United States, after much larger countries like Canada or the UK, China, and India, in which cases I think much of the traffic has to do with business calls rather than people calling their relatives back home. Tourism, or ethnic tourism, which is a term that Manuel Orozco and other colleagues coined to talk about how people living in the diaspora return back home every year. In the case of the Dominican Republic, it's usually during Christmas. And of course, the Dominican tourism market has increased tremendously in the last decade or so. But the less noticeable, perhaps, but equally important for our purposes at least, is that at least 500,000 people of Dominican origin return every year to visit their relatives. They spend money there, they stay in hotels perhaps, or in people's homes, and it's a significant investment of money in the Dominican economy. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we don't have comparable data of this kind as detailed for Cubans or Puerto Ricans, but I'm sure if we were able to tap into that issue, it would be also quite important. In terms of remittances, back again to this issue, because again, the Dominican Republic is such an important recipient of remittances from abroad. The United States, of course, is the first source of money that is sent back home, about two-thirds of all remittances in 2008. Spain has become the second largest source of remittances, and Puerto Rico, which used to be second, now is third, probably because of the declining value of the dollar vis-a-vis the euro. And although I'm not going to focus on the Dominican community in Puerto Rico, there's a chapter in the book that also does that. And then places like Italy and other European countries, particularly like Switzerland, the Netherlands, Germany, have become also quite interestingly important sources of remittances, because Dominicans have been moving to different places in those areas, as well as in Latin America. I said I wasn't going to talk about Puerto Rico, but at least there's one image here that I think is quite significant. The proliferation of remittance agencies such as La Nacional or RIA, and I'm sure here in New York there are some of these, as well as other companies that tend to focus wherever there are large numbers of Dominicans. And if you can read the Spanish, you know that it's not just remittances, but also telephone calls, airplane tickets, photocopies, faxes, sending packages, all kinds of services that are important for the Dominican immigrant community. And these are ways of keeping in touch and connecting very concretely with the relatives back home. Peggy Levin has also talked about social remittances in her work, and more recently Juan Flores has added the term cultural remittances. I'm using here an image by Karen Whalen, a colleague from Puerto Rico who has worked in the Dominican Republic. La Gran Manzana, the Big Apple, and this very proud young man standing in front of that, you know, very humble place, probably connected to New York through remittances as well. And some of these places in the Dominican Republic show a very strong influence of New York-based immigrants. And in fact, there's an increasing circulation of people, culture, money, and other kinds of cultural practices. So that's the Dominican case, and I'm just sort of basically summarizing some of the main issues in the book. In the second case, I'm also using Peggy Levitz and Nina Glick-Schiller's term of classifying Cuba as a disinterested and denouncing state. I have some trouble with the terms that are used here, that's why I'm using them as under quotes, but still, it sort of captures a lot of what the relationship between the Cubans abroad and the Cuban government looked like. I use this image of a very glossy magazine called Correo de Cuba, which is a subtitled Revista de la Inmigración Cubana, a journal of the Cuban migration, and explicitly with President Raúl Castro's image on the cover, because it says a lot about the kinds of issues that are raised in the Cuba diaspora Cuban government relationship, or lack thereof. On the one hand, Cuba is trying to reach out to its diaspora, especially because of the significance of remittances, of which I'll be talking in a minute, as well as visits by Cuban Americans, but also as a way to incorporate different aspects of the diaspora, not just in the United States. And in fact, this particular journal is much more targeted at the Cuban diaspora in other parts of the world, Latin America, Europe, and even Africa. So this is a very complicated relationship. On the one hand, the Cuban government wants to continue to promote Cubans to send money and to go back to Cuba. On the other hand, again, if you read the Spanish, this is a very political message that it wants to incorporate the Cuban diaspora into the revolutionary project. And it can do that because over the last 20 years or so, many Cubans have left the island, not necessarily because of political reasons, not necessarily because they disagree with the government, but primarily for economic reasons. Little Havana is sort of comparable to Quisqueya Heights and El Barrio here in New York, although this particular image of Varadero, the very well-known resort in Havana, has disappeared. Near Havana, I mean. But it says a lot about the nostalgia and the kind of imaging of Cuba, pre-revolutionary Cuba, that many of the older exiles remember of the Cuba in the 1950s. And of course, when they go back, they often feel that Cuba no longer exists, at least as they remember it. La Sagüecera, which is Spanish pronunciation of Southwest, in Southwest Miami, again, would be sort of a similar equivalent to some of the Latino barrios here in New York City, with a lot of the same kinds of small businesses and bodegas and restaurants and the Cuban symbols of the nation. One interesting aspect of the image on the left, of the Versalles restaurant, which is where Cubans plot every year to go back to Cuba when Fidel and Raúl die, is that the map of Cuba that is used in Miami doesn't correspond to the current Cuba. It's the Cuba before 1959, which had 7 provinces, I think, and now it has 13. So it's a way of not letting time pass by and not accepting the changes that have taken place after the revolution. So a lot of interesting cultural aspects coming in this area. Yucas, I was trying to look for a term that was equivalent to Dominican York or to New Rican, and I couldn't find it. Of course, Cuban American would be the most common term, but yuca, if you know the Spanish, of course, refers both to the staple that is very common in Caribbean food, but also young urban Cuban Americans. And I think these young white Cuban Americans, very well educated, they just finished their university studies, exemplify another kind of second generation, a second generation that's grown in Miami, that knows Cuba only through the lenses of their parents and grandparents, very close to Cuba. Many of them have never been back to Cuba, but they still identify primarily as Cuban or perhaps as Cuban American. So this would be the equivalent of the other two cases that I mentioned, the so-called Dominican Yorks and the New Yorkers. We do have some data on telephone calls from the U.S. to Cuba, but remember that the Dominican Republic was around 300 million calls per year compared to the Dominicans. Not that the Cubans don't call that often, but it's much more expensive. So that by the year 2008, which is the most the highest number of telephone calls recorded, Cubans were calling at the level of about 60 million. Which is interesting because of the fact that there's no direct communication between Cuba and the United States. It's very expensive, as I said before, and in fact, many of the older Cubans don't have anyone to call any longer, except those of us, including myself, who have more recent contacts with distant relatives. But again, this is sort of in the process of developing an unofficial transnationalism that began at a very, very low level in the beginning of the decade and now has expanded, not as much as the Dominican case, but still significant compared to what was there before. Another way of measuring transnationalism, again comparing it to the Dominican case, is the number of Cuban Americans who have visited Cuba. And here are a couple of interesting examples. One is that the Cubans who were going to visit relatives increased since the 1990s and reached the highest level before the current number of about 124,000 visitors to Cuba of Cuban American origin. Unfortunately, the numbers that I've seen with the visit of the Pope recently to Cuba perhaps suggest that twice as many Cubans are now visiting, about 240,000, but I still have to check the sources. In any case, also what happened in 2004 was that President Bush decided to restrict visits to Cuba, and that's why you get such a significant decrease, and then an increase after Obama came into power with the relaxation of these travel restrictions as well as remittance sending. The equivalent of remittances and the cultural remittances that are sent to Cuba are the so-called paqueticos in Spanish, the small packages that include medicines and food and all kinds of goods and eyeglasses, anything that is necessary for relatives to send to their loved ones in Cuba. Extremely expensive as well because of the lack of any kind of communication between the two countries. And I should mention, I haven't mentioned that Cuba and the United States don't have diplomatic relations and there are no commercial flights between Havana and Miami. A couple of these two images, I think, suggest a couple of very interesting patterns. First of all, that Western Union has become the single most important remittance agency in Havana, about 150 offices, particularly in the capital, but also in other major cities throughout Cuba. And on the other hand, Cubans who receive remittances have to change that money in dollars or euros or whatever other foreign currency in what is known as the CUC or the CUC. It's a convertible currency that is usually converted at 80 cents, 90 cents, depending on, now I think it's 90 cents, but it's still very favorable to the Cuban government because every time that happens, of course, they charge a commission. And these have become everyday scenes in Cuba. Everyone, theoretically at least, has access to the Western Union agencies and to the money that they can then use to buy essential stuff. And then the so-called shoppings, which would be the Cuban pronunciation of shopping center, have become, again, especially in Havana and other places where remittances have been being sent in large numbers, quite ordinary happenings. The Western Union sign is right there in the middle, the yellow one. And other than the presence of the Cuban flag and the fact that these are Cubans in Cuba shopping the same kinds of consumer items that they would do in Puerto Rico or in the Dominican Republic, it's quite similar. But the difference is that only people who have access to the so-called CUC can actually go to these places, and that has introduced a number of inequalities in the Cuban population that are still sort of being worked through. But beyond the economic impact of remittances, I think as well with the along with the idea that it's also cultural and social practice that are sent back to Cuba with the money and with the visits, one of the interesting things I think that has happened in Cuba, especially since the 1990s, is that migration has become a topic of reflection for art, for writers, for culture in general. And this particular performance in Havana refers to, the island in the middle could be thought of as a balsa, or as one of the rafts that Cubans, and also in the background, that Cubans used, especially in 1994, to try to reach U.S. soil. And that has become, again, a major concern for Cuban culture, and there are other expressions in music, for example, as well, and suggest the fact that the Cuban diaspora, which used to be a taboo topic before 1989, now has become the major one of the major issues in culture. So the final case then is the Puerto Rican case. I think this is from the Central Archives, this image of the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, the Migration Division from the early 1960s. And this is the image I think also is significant, because it suggests that the Puerto Rican government really transplanted itself to the United States. And this is, again, very well documented here at the Central Archive, how the Migration Division and later the Department of Puerto Rican Community Affairs was able for several decades to work almost as a colonial consulate or embassy, perhaps, because they really attempted to connect the two populations, the populations of Puerto Rican origin here, as well as in on the island. So this is probably familiar to many of you, but the significant and extraordinary growth of the Puerto Rican population in the United States has outpaced the very slow growth of the Puerto Rican population back home. And although recently I was in a panel with demographers who questioned really whether the census actually measured real population loss, this is the official version of it, so that between 2000 and 2010, Puerto Rico lost about 80,000 persons. That's about 2.2% of the population. And everyone agrees that the major reason for that has been migration to the United States, the other major reason being a low fertility rate and a low mortality rate. But migration, as you can see from this graph, has increased tremendously, at least from the official numbers, which as I mentioned already, suggest that the Puerto Rican population in the United States has become larger than the Puerto Rican population on the island. I can think of only a few historical cases, like 19th century Ireland or perhaps Israel at some point in the 20th century, that have experienced such a large population movement, a continuing one after five or six decades, and the fact, again, that there are more people of this particular origin living outside the territory of its nationality. The U.S., but also Puerto Ricans on the island, express their identity and their public role every year in the single most important expression here, as well as on the island, with the participation of people, especially from the mayors and everyone else who can get the money, who knows where, to come to participate in the parade. The new Eurekan Poets Cafe would be another example, again, of these sort of artistic remittances and the connections between Puerto Ricans here and there. And also, of course, the appropriation of the term Eurekan, which, like Dominican New York, was a very negative term, at least on the island, to suggest that Puerto Ricans in the mainland were not as authentic as Puerto Ricans back home. And again, this is another sort of expression of comparison, I think, between the three groups, among the three groups, and the second generation, and the kinds of attitudes and culture that come with them, as well as the language practices. In Chicago, this is a fascinating, I think, image of El Paseo Boricua, called the Sea of Flags, and a couple of interesting icons there. Of course, the huge steel flag at the end of Division Street in the New York Northwest Side, but also Lolita Lebron on the front, and also with the flag of Lares, and other kinds of cultural aspects. Again, suggest to me the very strong connections between that particular community and other places on the island. And of course, wherever there's more than two Puerto Ricans, there's a parade. And Orlando has become the second largest site of Puerto Ricans anywhere after New York City, with about 300,000 now, according to the latest census data that we've looked at. And so again, very interesting issues happening there. One of the issues that I might just note briefly is that the Puerto Rican community in Orlando is a combination of people coming directly from the island, coming directly from other parts of the United States, people who speak Spanish and who speak English as their first languages, people who have more connections to the island, as well as people who have more connections to the places in the United States. So I think that's one of the reasons why it's becoming increasingly interesting as a place to do field work. And this particular image, I think the Disney-esque version of El Morro in the middle of nowhere. I remember the first time I went there, you know, and Asociación Borinqueña, the use of the term Borinquen also is interesting because of the emotional connections to the pre-Columbian past and so forth. And now just to begin my wrapping up, one issue that I haven't talked about in the Dominican case as much, but I will say something about it in the Puerto Rican case, is the increasing rate of return migration. Especially since the 1970s. This particular woman, Milagros Martinez, I think is her name, illustrates a trend that hasn't been studied well, because she returned back to Puerto Rico, but her family stayed, and I think she's showing her a very sad face, the image of her husband and three grown sons that remain in the United States. So some of the emotional transnationalism also that's going on, the connections between people here and there, and the emotional cost of separation, I think are quite well represented in this image. The final issue then, remittances, that I mentioned in the beginning, it's quite paradoxical that although Puerto Rico has sent the largest number of people of the three crises, it sends their migrants send the least amount of money to the island. One of the reasons is, I think, has to do with federal transfers. So in this image, I have the private remittances, which again are roughly $350 million a year, compared to federal transfers that have increased tremendously from about $8 billion in 2000 to about $16 billion in the last year that I had access to, 2010, I think it is. So, and this has to do, many of you know that Puerto Rico has entered a recession since the last 6 years, since 2006. And one of the main reasons Puerto Rico has survived is because of the increasing access to Social Security funds, to veterans benefits, and other kinds of federal remittances, if you want to call them that. And my argument in the book, and also briefly here, is that private remittances would increase tremendously were federal transfers to decrease. And the only reason why they haven't increased so much is because Puerto Ricans have access to this other kind of money. So compared to Cuba and the Dominican Republic that don't have access to those kinds of monies. So finally, I want to emphasize the constant circulation of movement, of movement of people, money, cultural practices, between the Hispanic Caribbean, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, and Cuba, and the United States. And in the book, I also try to show that this is not a new phenomenon, although it has increased over the past 5 or 6 decades. In the case of Dominicans, I think it's quite clear that Dominicans are engaged in something that we may call transnationalism, meaning that they call home quite frequently, they go frequently to visit their relatives, they send money at record numbers compared to other places in the Caribbean. So in that regard, I think Dominican is a very interesting case for the study of these transnational connections. In the case of Cubans, I think the level of all those practices, sending money, calling home, visiting relatives, and so on, is quite reduced, but has increased over the past decade or so, and also I think is connected to the increasing difficulties in Cuba and the persisting special period that doesn't seem to end anytime soon. And finally, in the case of Puerto Rico, I argue in the book basically that it has developed a broad kind of transnationalism and has strong connections to the colonial relationship between Puerto Rico and the United States. And one of the ways in which this colonial transnationalism has evolved has to do with the extension of government agencies from the island to the mainland for much of the 20th century, and also the impact of these agencies on connecting the two communities ever since. So going back to the, you know, the idea of the book and the title of the book, I use the term borders in a metaphorical as well as a literal term. I mean that the separation or the limits between the Hispanic Caribbean and the United States have blurred but not disappeared. And I'm well aware of the fact that there are boundaries as well, political boundaries that separate, especially Cuba and the Dominican Republic, not so much in Puerto Rico because of the free access of movement between the two places. But I'll just leave it at that with an open question. Are borders blurring, or is it something else that we really haven't sort of developed language to understand? Thank you very much.
I flew, you know, the night before and last night so that I could come today because I lost my voice. So I'm hoping that you can bear this voice that is not sexy, it's just that is sick. So, okay, can we do this? And you want me to try? And I'm gonna read. I tend to talk too much, and if I put it in writing, I thought that I was going to not abuse your time. Blurred Borders has many intellectual and practical merits that make this book an indispensable reading for scholars specializing in these three countries, their peoples, or their modern migratory processes, whether intermigration from island to island, or migration to the U.S., Blurred Borders will appeal to seasoned, established scholars because of the position or the author takes on the ongoing academic debate regarding the migrant populations and their relationships with ascending societies. The student and young readers will also have a ball with Blurred Borders because this book is written in a very clear, straightforward language, read or convoluted jargon and ambiguous statements that leave the reader wondering and asking, what in the world is the author saying? Contrary to the escurridizo author, Duany is bold, direct, clear, consistent, and persuasive. In Bloody Borders, Transnational Migration from the Hispanic Caribbean, Jorge Duany continues his fine work on transnationalism. In this monograph, Duany shows an extraordinary capacity for synthesizing in a few pages the long history of modern migration to the U.S., of Cubans, Dominicans, Puerto Ricans. Dominican migration to Puerto Rico is also examined in the text. With regard to migration to the U.S., this book vindicates the importance of historical process that is at the root of the presence of most Latinos that inhabit the eastern coast of the United States today. And in doing so, the book becomes a welcome instrument for better understanding this large segment of the U.S. Atlantic Coast population that has often been neglected in mainstream academic scholarship and media. Ultimately, and more specifically, Duany puts forth the argument that in order to fully understand the dialectics of similarities and sometimes chart differences among these three parallel migration flows into the U.S. from the Hispanic Caribbean, a special attention needs to be given to the role of the state in shaping and defining migrants and in designing and controlling migrants' relationships with the home country. Duany suggests taking into account, one, the type of political relations that each of these sending states has established and defined towards its migrants, And second, the types of relationships that at the international level take place between the United States as a whole and each of the Spanish Caribbean states. And it is this differentiated relation structures that, in Duany's view, allow us to totally understand the inner reality of the migrations of Puerto Ricans, Cubans, and Dominicans into the U.S., beyond the first glance similarities in language and Spanish Afro-Taino cultural heritage that may lead more than one uninformed observer to perceive all of them as a more or less similar Caribbean branch of Hispanics, whose life and behavior in the United States have many elements in common, particularly their relationship with sending countries' culture, one that they maintain, recreate, and transmit despite the rejection of their home countries and the receiving societies, whether in Puerto Rico, the case of the Dominican people, or in the United States, the case of all the three, Cubans, Dominicans, and Puerto Ricans. Duany approaches these intra-hemispheric migrations from the insular Spanish Caribbean within the widespread current of transnational studies, reinforcing the notion that the nation state, especially in the case of these Caribbean countries, is no longer an adequate framework within which to understand contemporary societies. At the same time, Duany's critical perspective on transnationalism is definitely an added contribution to the field, since many studies guided by a transnational approach seem to be narrow in highlighting the transnational dynamics of contemporary migration as a new phenomenon. In Blurred Borders, Duany's theoretical view departs from Michael King's definition of borders and boundaries with regard to migrants and their relationship to the state, both in the sending and in the receiving societies. Kearney proposes a definition of boundaries and borders where the first are perceived as legal geographical delimitations, while the latter are constructed as cultural spaces that may emerge in opposition to boundaries. Kearney felt that his theoretical model could be very well applied to other migrant groups residing in countries similar to the ones he has studied. I find that Duany actually takes Kearney's proposal a step forward, at least in two aspects. One, Duany compares migrant groups that come from societies that are both receiving and sending societies, at least in the case of two of the three societies compared. Two, in each of these societies, the state plays an active but distinctive role in defining and acknowledging the migrants. And three, there's a third one, sorry, Duany places under the transnational lenses Cubans and Puerto Ricans, two groups, that because of their country's political status had been perceived as different from any other immigrant group that comes from a nation state and live in the U.S. Because transnational theory has been associated mostly with international migrants migrating from independent nation states, neither Cubans nor Puerto Ricans were imagined as transnational people. Dominicans residing in the U.S., however, were perceived as the quintessential transnational migrants. Cubans and Puerto Ricans, on their part, irrespective of their linkages that Jorge chose so clearly here, irrespective of their linkages with the native countries, were constructed simply as immigrants and migrants. Blurred borders, expands the theoretical scope of transnationalism by finding transnational practices and behaviors in groups that up to this moment were thought to be immune to transnationalism. A direct consequence of the mobility of these groups is that each of one creates communities that clearly exhibit well-established linkages with a sending country. These linkages reflect transnationalism and the author's view. Transnationalism is perhaps more apparent in the high level of remittance to the home country and in the culture and political relationships these migrants maintain with the sending societies. Remittance sent by Cubans, Dominicans, and Puerto Ricans generate much needed dollars in the economies of the home country, which are dollarized, irrespective of the political relationship of these countries with the U.S. Duany establishes a nexus in the dollarization of these countries' economy and the impact of migrants' remittance, and the impact migrant remittance has on them, despite the fact that each of these economies relate to the U.S. differently. That is, one has colonial ties, the other neocolonial, and the third takes pride in its complete separation from the U.S. economic domination. Duany's work, however, reminds us that una cosa es la que piensa el burro y otra cosa piensa el que lo acarrea. Remittance, whether we speak of its impact on the sending country, or we choose to speak about migrants' commitment to send remittance, it is clear it is an equalizing agent among migrants. Cuban, Dominican, and Puerto Rican migrants are de facto connected in their practice of sending things home that are anxiously awaited by the people who receive them and effectively used by the states that allow and condone these transfers. Duany also speaks of another transnational symbol that typifies Cubans, Dominicans, and Puerto Ricans in the U.S. and Dominicans in Puerto Rico. The vibrant communities each of these groups has created that remind us of certain areas of the sending countries. Cubans had built La Pequeña Habana in Miami, Florida. Dominicans, for their part, had constructed the Aquisqueya in the Heights in Manhattan, in New York City. And a few blacks toward the eastern part of Manhattan, Puerto Ricans erected El Barrio Puertorriqueño, El Barrio Boricua. What makes this neighborhood stand out is that each has been appropriated and given a new birth certificate that identifies them as Cuban, Dominican, and Puerto Rican spaces. These delimitations, of course, have very little to do, if anything, with the names of these neighborhoods as they are listed in the official maps and other documents pertaining to geographic divisions or neighborhoods in the city. Duany's argument is that the social practices in these neighborhoods that are linked to the ascending countries, whether in the form of cultural linkages such as music, food, or of a business sector that feeds on selling memorabilia that alleviate migrants' nostalgic state of mind, or that provide tailored services and products to satisfy migrant needs for services, are all transnational, and that as such, they create borders within boundaries. It is quite visible, for instance, where Dominican Washington Heights begins and ends, where El Barrio begins and ends, and the same can be said about La Pequeña Habana. As in the case of remittance, these borders are also an equalizing agent among transnational migrants. Duany suggests that the sending countries are transformed and impacted by migrants and their neighborhoods established in the receiving societies. The cultural borders move when migrants travel back home, when they send money, or remain attached to the political life in the country of origin, when ideas about life in their neighborhoods penetrate the sending society. Duany's point is that in each case, the legal definition of the geographic limitation is blurred by the cultural borders. Particularly useful and with healthy political implications in the contemporary U.S. debates over immigration is Duany's effort to remind readers of the evidence of vigorous transnational practices of early non-Latino waves of immigrants whose Latino descendants more or less have self-identified with the notion of U.S. mainstream Anglo-centered identity and often tend to condemn and deride Latino immigrants and their children as clinging too much to their particular national heritage. Similarly, while most writings dealing with Dominican transnationalism in particular have painted too much of a rosy picture of what it means to be transnational, Duany is not necessarily taking that super optimistic approach in describing Dominicans as transnational, as he takes time to point out the difficulties the group faces in settling in the U.S. Finally, perhaps Duany's main contribution to transnational understanding in migration studies is that boundaries get blurred, not erased, in the way migrants interact.
Jorge Duany is one of the few scholars whose works are read as eagerly on the island of Puerto Rico as they are in the academia of the continental United States. His latest book and publication, Blurred Borders, cements his standing as a well-balanced, well-informed, and leading commentator on immigration and migration for all the peoples of the Hispanic Caribbean. In this volume of 10 chapters with introduction and conclusion, he compares and contrasts the migration of the island peoples of Cuba, the Dominican Republic, and Puerto Rico. His contextualizing approach considers not just those who arrive on distant shores, but how their initial leaving and frequent returning have generated cultural and political effects upon each of these island societies. As he states in the introduction, form, frequency, and intensity of transnationalism largely hinges on the nature of the relationship between sending and receiving societies. The book is a virtual tour de force that will be cited by virtually every scholar in Puerto Rican and Latin American studies because it advances scholarship beyond the confines that makes each of these peoples into an island to itself and presents the Caribbean as an archipelago in both geographical and historical terms. Meriting special praise is the book's graphic classification of the types of transnational migration for the three peoples. That's on page 230. This table at the end of the book is the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow for those who read each of the chapters for Duany's careful exploration of these similarities and differences. His methodological approach is also to be praised. His presentation of the contemporary statistical data is made compelling by his description of the human face of the real life experience. His is the classic marriage between sociology with anthropology, and it matches generalized data about social behavior with on-site observation, weaving together these separate strands. The result is a richly textured fabric of culture, politics, history, economics, and migration that faithfully images the complex reality of the peoples of the Hispanic Caribbean. Even if a reader disagrees with some aspect of Duany's assessment or notices a lack of unevenness in certain topics, no one can help but admire the fashion of his design for covering so much diversity and doing it so well. Each of the 10 chapters of the book is derived from a previous publication. That's a familiar route to book writing in today's world of internet scholarship. But, and this is important, to avoid the disjointed product that often comes from this kind of cut and pasting publishing, Duany has generously provided an introduction to each chapter that helps the reader integrate the different articles into the larger vision of the book. These brief introductions serve as couplings that preserve the direction of the entire volume, much like railroad cars carrying different cargo are coupled together, drawn by the locomotive. It is a courtesy to be welcome to do this sort of coupling, and it will be of great utility for classroom use of this volume. The introduction of the book makes the important point that the nation state is not the natural limit of the modern world, and that the proper focus for transnational migration should be the people. Early on, Duany makes the mandatory excursion into self-revelation that is common in contemporary academia. But rather than a painful self-flagellation on the altar of postmodernism, Duany presents his personal history stoically. He is a Cuban-born transplant to Puerto Rico who has written extensively about Dominicans after studying in the United States. He makes the case that he better understands each nation's people because he has been forced in his personal life to constantly compare and contrast his different experiences of Caribbean identity. One has to admire the impartiality that Duany exhibits towards the competing terminologies current in the study of each of these peoples and inherent in his multidisciplinary method. Thus, for instance, he exercises due diligence in explaining the history and the use of rival terms like hybridization, creolization, syncretism, bricolage, modernization, and globalization. After exploring the advantages and disadvantages for each term, as a gentleman that he is, he establishes the logic for his own preferences without denigrating the value of other studies that produce rival labor. In this regard, I can offer a special comment on how he uses the concept of the Great Puerto Rican Migration. And he uses this term as well as pioneer and revolving door migration, attributing them to the Fordham sociologist Clara Rodriguez from her 1989 book on Puerto Ricans in the USA. However, Clara Rodriguez took the concepts from the 1982 book, The Minority Report, which carried a chapter, Puerto Ricans in the States, a Struggle Identity, written by su servidor, and Ana Maria Diaz when she was still Ramirez, and not Diaz Stevens. And I make this point to strengthen the case for Duany's multidisciplinary approach. Stevens-Arroyo and Diaz Stevens coined the term the Great Puerto Rican Migration to describe the 18-year period from 1946 to 64. Because most demographers at that time had used the biennial census data, Puerto Rican migration statistics usually had treated each decade separately. So you did the 40s, and then you did the 50s, and then you did the 60s, making the 1950s the decade of huge out-migration from Puerto Rico to the United States, but ending abruptly in the 1960s. By using cultural, social, and political data to connect the last 4 years of the 1940s and the first 4 years of the 1960s to the numbers of Puerto Rican migration, however, we found that the takeoff in migration began with the end of the Second World War and the emergent hegemony of the Popular Democratic Party in Luis Muñoz Marín. Conversely, the Great Puerto Rican Migration ended 1964 when Muñoz left the governorship, and this continued with changes in U.S. immigration reform that allowed massive influx from Mexico, the Dominican Republic, and other parts of the Western Hemisphere in 1965 with the change of the immigration law. And so the status of Puerto Ricans as newcomers and the Hispanic immigrant group was permanently altered. Civil rights legislation and the money given for the political organization of minority groups under Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty were other significant political and social events that radically refocused Puerto Ricans in the United States on politics here at the very time that the island began an enduring search for replacement for Muñoz, Operation Bootstrap, and the Commonwealth status. These change conditions set the stage for the revolving door migration in and out of New York and other places like Central Florida and the Poconos in Northeast Pennsylvania. The migration from Puerto Rico did not cause the civil rights movement, the war on poverty, or the changes in the immigration law. It was rather these events that shaped the migration and dictated its development. And just to look at that again, look how high the numbers are, and you see it's in 1953 in the month of May, which actually is the very month that my wife left Puerto Rico, 1953. I don't know if there's some sort of poetic destiny in that I would marry the woman that left in America. But remember, in terms of absolute numbers, population of Puerto Rico in 53 was half of what it is now. So although the numbers you see going up towards 2010 are very high, remember that the numbers that peaked in 53 was with half of the Puerto Rican population. You're talking about 40% of the population leaving in 18 years. And Jorge made the point just off the cuff that the only immigration that compares to that is the Irish immigration at the time of the Great Potato Famine. That's the only historical comparison. And the Irish potato famine was caused by natural disaster. The migration from Puerto Rico was planned by the Partido Popular Democratico. I have this article here, and I'm going to leave it with Carlos because I'm going to see him later on. You know, when you're 70 years old like I am, half the things you wrote when you were young, you wish people would forget. But this is one I hope they remember. And I have a reason for doing that I'll get to in a minute. In sum, demographic numbers are best understood as results from interaction with significant cultural changes, political currents, community movements, and an altered socioeconomic scenario. You put all those together to understand the numbers. In an ever-intense interaction, each aspect affects the others. Hispanic Caribbean identity, then, can be seen as a result of these factors as they impact people and their different lives. As Duany correctly states in his introduction, as cited above, the study of migration is not about demographic numbers or election results. It's about people. Blurred Borders demonstrates that Jorge Duany has advanced this kind of multi-layered analysis for Cubans, Dominicans, and Puerto Ricans by examining what we'll call la banda allí, la banda allá. This is an approach devoutly to be wished upon everyone in academia. The constant and ecumenical evolution of many different insights into a coherent body of knowledge that is based on proven premises. And I know that it's good that Ramon is here because she's a leader in Dominican studies, and she's not 70 yet. She's got a long ways to go. But there's going to be a point at which the terminology that is coined at the beginning of a study becomes something that's a bit of a treasure that has to be constantly passed on, reevaluated. And so I think that that's one of the things that Jorge has done in his book masterfully. Given the genesis of the book, it is understandable that some chapters, such as the second, which is on transnationalism as a concept, the fifth on Puerto Ricans in Orlando, and the tenth on Dominicans in Puerto Rico, are the easiest to characterize as scholarly research findings. Others, like the sixth and the seventh, both on the Cuban migration, are more speculative, extrapolating from previous research. And my guess is that that's the chapter he got the most criticism for, by the way. This might disappoint those expecting each chapter to be of the same type. However, when looking for insights rather than for perfection, this volume must be ranked high up on the scale. The overall presentation of the book by the University of North Carolina Press is noteworthy. The cover is colorful and attractive. The type font is pleasing to the eye. The index and bibliography are complete. And there's no typos that's worth complaining about. Without dampening the praise, a few issues can be mentioned, perhaps for discussion. For instance, the economy of Puerto Rico has been based on certain presumptions about the island's colonial status. This information reflects similar loyalties to national madonnas for Cubans, Caridad del Cobre, and Dominicans, Our Lady of Alta Gracia. Now, I can testify from my previous life that maintaining these loyalties within the churches of the United States did not just happen. There was a conscious decision by ecclesiastical leaders to adapt these traditional feast days to what is called pastoral praxis. Moreover, the Great Puerto Rican Migration, as also the Cuban Exodus and the Dominican Wave, were studied by church officials in both countries, leading to a strategy of transnational ministry based on sound demographic and sociological principles. These pastoral innovations included training non-Hispanic church personnel in the language and culture of the places of origin, making community-building resources available, including faith-based social services engaged with government programs, and sponsoring language and cultural preservation organizations. In many cases, it was not the people that sought the church, but the church that sought the people. All these efforts of a half century are well documented and are accessible in the considerable literature on Latino religion. And while a book author doesn't have to say everything in order to say something, the role of religion merits greater attention in future studies, especially because the churches seem to have outlived many militant political and cultural movements. In sum, Blurred Borders is a comparative analysis of the Hispanic Caribbean and the United States that both answers existing questions as well as raising new ones. Read it.
In your research, did you look at the interface between the migration and the healthcare facilities in terms of how receptive they've been in terms of meeting the psychological and physical healthcare needs of the migrants, given the fact that the healthcare system in the United States has been Euro-Anglo dominated, with very much research indicating a large presence of institutionalized racism?
My short answer would be no. I did not look at that issue, and I think it's an important issue that should be looked at in future research.
I really enjoyed your presentation. I'm really excited to read the book. It sounds really wonderful, and part of what I like about it is how it approaches the diversity of the Caribbean while looking at it as a unit, kind of looking also at the differences within it. And I'm just wondering if you think that the three cases you present, do they kind of offer different kind of typologies or models from where then you could think about other cases in the Caribbean? So I'm thinking, for example, Puerto Rican case, although it's really interesting to think of in relationship to the other Hispanic Caribbean, it's interesting to think about in terms of French and Dutch. And then I'm wondering if perhaps the case of Cuba, is there a way to kind of move out of its exceptionalism and think about it in relationship to Haiti, in relationship to other places where perhaps communication was impeded in the ways that you talk about? And then also, the Dominican case might be interesting to think about in relationship to Jamaica and other kind of Caribbean nations.
I hinted a couple of times in the book comparing Puerto Rico to the non-independent Hispanic, Caribbean territories, not just the French and the Dutch, but also the remaining overseas territories of the United Kingdom. And after I wrote the book, actually, I participated in several seminars where that was the main point of the comparison. And it's quite amazing. You know, of course, full well the case of Guadeloupe and Martinique, which, regardless of the differences in terms of some of the main issues raised here, sound very similar, or at least they merit a more systematic comparison, questions of identity, of language and race and so on, and the fact that also for those non-independent territories, there's a free access, there's a shared citizenship within metropole, and that raises all kinds of interesting issues. In the case of Cuba, I think the more relevant comparison would be with other socialist or former socialist states that have actually changed their relationships with the diaspora. I'm thinking of Vietnam, even China, the former Soviet Union, some of the former European socialist countries. Because, for example, going back to the typology that Nina Gitschitter and Peggy Levy proposed, they actually mentioned some of those countries, but the research hasn't been done, except perhaps with the little more traditional literature about exiles, and then considering Cubans as a special type of migrant who leaves their country because of political reasons, and then that kind of comparison. With the case of the Dominican Republic, however, I don't think Ramona can tell me, but I don't think those kinds of comparisons have been made with other non-Hispanic Caribbean countries with respect to migration, at least. But I think, yes, I mean, that's a whole different research agenda that could be pursued.
You had up on the screen about telephone calls back home and the really nice advertisement calling home from your home. I'm wondering if you can take that one step further and actually think of it as calling home literally from your home computer. Because now I'm not sure how much people are actually picking up a phone as they are picking up a cell phone, as they are getting out their iPod, getting on Facebook, Skype, Ubu, all of these new methods of communication, transnational, most definitely communication, global communication. Can that be as easily tracked as the way you can call up the FCC or however you tapped into those statistics? Can that be as easily tracked? Has it been looked at? I know academia, by the time it gets published, is usually 10 years behind everything. So in 10 years, we'll read about Facebook and we'll say we're not doing that anymore. But have you looked at any of that? Have you thought about that? Is that discussion amongst diaspora groups that you've worked with?
My sense of it is that it's much more difficult to track. I haven't seen myself statistics on that kind of traffic, but it might explain, for example, the slight decrease here in the middle part of the first decade of the 21st century, because I think in fact that it's what's happening, that people are using more accessible and cheaper forms of communicating through the internet rather than telephone calls. So Skype and so on would be my guess. Again, I think you may be right. I mean, it may take 5-6 years until we see good ethnographic research, the type that, would be not just my experience or two or three people doing this, but, actually a survey or perhaps some other kind of participant observation as well of the kinds of connections that may be now developing virtually rather than, people to people.
And that's the phrase for it? Virtual.
This is the term that he's using, which he didn't coin. I think it's been already coined by people doing work on the internet, in the last decade. But this would apply now, I think, in a very interesting way now to migrants who then use this kind of virtual transnationalism to keep in touch with their relatives.
I'd like to add to that this is an international phenomenon. If you remember Manuel Castells' work on the informational age, sketch this out in very large categories, and as a matter of fact, there's all kinds of studies about the frequency of this kind of communication. That is, you're right, it's replacing the kind of old-fashioned ways of doing things.
I had something similar with one of your graphics where it shows the what was sent to Cuba and how much the numbers were low, and it made me think of my experience when I went to Cuba a couple of years ago. I met with a friend who lives in Miami, and she said, oh, we're on the mule plane. And I said, what is the mule plane? And from Cancun to Mexico, it's about 45 minutes. And apparently, I think it was more than half of the people on the plane were Cubans going to Cuba who go on a regular basis, and they collect suitcases or boxes or as much as they can take for other people who live in Miami who either can't or won't go. Mm-hmm. And how do you track something like that? I thought was fascinating because I mean, to me it was kind of new, and I knew that I was going without papers and no one knew I was entering or exiting, which I thought that was fascinating in itself, that I happened to go to Cancun and said, oh my God, I'm so close, I've gotta go. And they don't stamp your passports, but at the same time, no one keeps track of all those boxes or suitcases going in. So to me, that would be like an enormous difference in that mm-hmm. particular graph that you were showing,
sure.
Perhaps similar to this whole virtual thing that we're talking about.
And I think that's why the term that I use, perhaps is another term, but the term unofficial transnationalism would apply well to the Cuban case, because it really takes place outside sort of the official ways, and remittances and other kinds of transfers that are not recorded, at least by the U.S. state, because then, by definition, you couldn't tell how many people were traveling. We do have numbers from the Cuban side, and again, it's a little difficult to they don't want to publish these numbers because they know that people are traveling illegally and so forth. But after Canadians, apparently, it's the U.S. that has been sending the largest number of tourists to Cuba, mm-hmm. and then of those, they're probably Cuban Americans, which now are legal tourists. I mean, they can go travel to Cuba to visit relatives. The non-Cubans, like yourself, I guess, would be the ones that are not officially traveling back home. But by definition, I think many of these transfers and remittances are not easy to track and not easy to count, because in many cases, it's not convenient for the people who are doing them, because, for example, they would have to pay taxes on whatever goods they're bringing into Cuba. But again, from both sides, we can sort of have a better picture, a larger picture of the sheer size of these transfers. For example, the number of flights that have been added to Miami-Havana, the Miami-Havana connection. I remember the last time I was in Cuba last year, they were remodeling the terminal where they have, they received the Cuban-American community. They simply can't handle it. I mean, this, the number of people that want to go there. And then the impact that has on people. So for example, a lot of the stores, a lot of the consumer items are bought with dollars by sent by relatives, cellular phones, for example, which now I think have been estimated at 1 million in Cuba. I'm sure most of those cell phones are not paid by Cubans in Cuba. They're paid by Cuban Americans in Miami who send them and then keep in touch with them. So there's this large scale traffic that by definition then cannot be really, you know, it must be a small proportion of a much larger phenomenon of all kinds of contacts that are taking place.
I also have a question on indicators. People have made allusion to telephone calls. I would like to speak about, would like you to speak about remittances, particularly comparing the case of Puerto Rico with the Dominican Republic and to some extent Cuba, but you know, particularly Puerto Rico, it is clear that in terms of official remittances, Puerto Rico or Puerto Ricans do not send a lot of remittances to Puerto Rico. But I wonder if that is also because of the age of the migration, meaning since the Puerto Rican migration is older than the Dominican migration, at least by a generation, and you may not have necessarily the family members in Puerto Rico to send money to, why would you be sending money to, number one. The second part of the question would be then, not just about sending money to people, but the ways in which you transfer money. I mean, do you need to go to Western Union or to Riambia to send money to Puerto Rico, or can you just send the money order?
Yeah.
Or send a check, or you know, you hand somebody an ATM card and you, and they get money out of Puerto Rico. So again, a question of indicators and what are the implications for transnationalism research?
I think I agree completely. I mean, one of the main differences in the Greek migration flows is that the Puerto Rican migration tends to be more mature, I would say. In other words, it started earlier, at least a more recent flow in the 1940s and 50s, and my apologies to Dr. Stevens-Arroyo and his wife for not citing that particular study, but I will in my next essay. But I mean, I think it's because of the, you know, a lot of time has passed by, and therefore many Puerto Ricans in the U.S. no longer have very close relatives, meaning their children, their father and mother, and therefore don't have the moral obligation to send money every month. Perhaps it could be, you know, a gift once a year or something else, a special occasion, and so on, but it's not the regular the regular sending of money that we see in the Dominican case in particular, or Mexican case, in which case we're talking about, you know, sort of nuclear families that have been separated very recently as a few years ago, and therefore have to send money back home. So I agree with that. I think the age of the year of departure, that's one of the variables. The question of the underestimating these are the official figures from the Junta de Planificación, the Puerto Rican Planning Board, and clearly they're very conservative. They must be at least twice as high.
These are not bank transfers, are they?
What's that?
Bank transfers?
No, it includes, you know, in the balance of payment data, it includes simply, it says private transfers. It could be both bank accounts or money that's being sent. My guess is that most of the money is taking place through the mail, regular mail. And I guess that could be studied. I haven't been able to do it. But if the post office were to give us, you know, some sense of how much money is being sent by regular mail through many orders, that would be wonderful. However, I was surprised when we did the study 2006, 2007, a fieldwork study in several places in Puerto Rico, which did not rely, and our questions were very open, and so that we wanted to know how much money do you receive or send by any means. Do you send packages? Do you send medicine? Anything. We really wanted to know. And we're surprised to find that only 5% of our Puerto Rican respondents said, yes, I do receive money from my relatives. It's 1 out of 20, compared to you know, 1/3 perhaps of all Dominicans, according to some of the surveys. So I agree that methodology is difficult, but there seems to be a major difference between the Puerto Rican case and the other cases with regard to remittances. I don't remember, you had a third question there?
We'll look at that.
Okay.
Since this is like, new, indeed, the study on migration, the case of Puerto Rico. So we have very little idea of what's happening. And also, I think that the fact that Puerto Rico uses dollar,
right,
in whatever we send here, like in the case of my family, we send money to Puerto Rico, my husband, brother, and the mother, and so on. And I wonder how could you track that as compared to the Dominican Republic. Anything that goes into the Dominican Republic that is not peso, but is dollar, whether it's a transfer from the bank or whether it is a check, personal check, in the format of dollar, will be computed by the government in the Dominican Republic because this is a foreign currency. So, but this is not the case of Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm. All of these, so Jorge, I think that you into something. All of these possible things that are going into Puerto Rico to people will be difficult to track because of the currency that is used there, because of the way that is sent there. And also, Jorge, pensaba yo, I thought that, you know, there is that mentality now created in the Dominican Republic about remittance. People know about that. And when you ask them, they can respond to something that they have registered already. Sure. But in the case of Puerto Rico, they know about welfare transfer, for instance, federal transfer, for instance. But are they acquainted with that kind of language that has now been used with them? This is, you know, this is very new. You bring Puerto Rican as a group that could be compared to other transnational people, and this is, you know, I think this is going to open the door now to find more stuff regarding the Puerto Rican people. Just one comment about things going to Cuba that, you know, people take in different ways. I don't know whether you look at the relationship of the Dominican Republic and Cuba and the flights that go to the Cuba on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And people going from the U.S., Dominicanos, Cubanos, you name it, to the Dominican Republic to go to Cuba because their passport is not going to be stamped, and it's actually closer, I think.
And Nassau.
Right, and cheaper. So, you know, we send things to Cubanos that we don't know through Dominicanos that are going to Cuba from the Dominican Republic, and it's sort of like a Wawa area, you know, they go very frequently. So, and how do you compute? Because they have found ways of sort of packaging things and making, you know, the right size, and so how
there's
do you compute
science
that?
To it.
Yeah, yeah.
This question of the indicators is very interesting. I think you can capture bank transfers. You know, the Federal Reserve will do that. If you send a check from here to Puerto Rico, it will be transferred. It will be counted on the national data. But I think there is something else behind that. I think the migrations are very different. You know, Puerto Ricans now, the maturing of the... I think what's going on is a lot of younger, more educated people coming out. I mean, that's the data that I see.
Mm-hmm.
Not everybody, but certainly that young cohort, are they going to send back money to their parents who are probably employed? If they're not employed, they're leaving. So I think there is a kind of an economic foundation for the transfer and the remittances. The population is not as poor as maybe, you know, Dominicans or Cubans sending back to support family. We just did a survey of farm workers, and they come and work and they send money back. Now, there are a couple of thousand of them left. But that's a migration that says remittance. So, I think it has to do with the nature of the people who come back and forth. But there are other indicators that I would look at, you know, if you wanted to test the hypothesis of transnationalism in the Puerto Rican case. I use some data that I can't remember. Don't ask me why. But the bulk of the tourism to Puerto Rico are actually from Puerto Ricans. It's like 2/3 to 1/3 in terms of the border. Now, you can say they're not staying in hotels. They stay with family. So it's not the return migration of all where people went back to work and whatever. It's a constant flow that is actually I think is more indicative of, you know. I'm debating conceptual, you know, you're saying if we want to go to the individual as the unit of analysis for transnationalism, that will be more telling than the remittances, which will be more of a quantitative, you know, kind of economic relation. And that family tie is very real, you know. Now, an indicator for telephone calls? You can. You know, I call my son with a Sprint phone that doesn't, unless we have data on the, or report, you know, the 787. But guess what? I carry a 787 cell phone. You know, so it's very hard to measure that because of the integration of the whole thing. But when you look at all indicators, I mean, tourism is a very good one because of the bulk of people that go every year. So I think this it's a conceptual issue of how we develop these indicators to measure what.
Mm-hmm. In my family, we have remittances the other way around because when Mina went back, she married this guy that had a store. He did very well. Mercedes and Michael didn't return to Puerto Rico, and they're kind of elderly now. So we get the money from Puerto Rico up here. And the other thing is what I would call nostalgic remittances that aren't money. Things like beans. I mean, every time the people come, oh, this is beans from the farm. You got to plant this, you know. So there's other ways that people connect, and I think the idea of remittances can even be expanded beyond just the change of money.
We were in the Dominican Republic last summer for the conference on the Spanish Caribbean that everyone was organizing. In the cab, I think on the way to the airport, several of us were there, and the cab driver was talking about his whole family in New Jersey and saying that he wasn't able to get a job in New Jersey, and he had returned to the Dominican Republic and was driving the cab and sending money to his family in New Jersey. And so I wonder, I mean, I thought that was a fascinating story, and I wonder to what degree we're trying to follow that sort of remittance going in that direction that ties in with 100% of where we go. I don't know if you've got the voice to comment on that, but have you seen much of that? Or?
No, but there are cases. There are cases in what you have Dominicans who left, who were living here, went back to the Dominican Republic or went back home. And there are members of the family that are in trouble here, for instance. So they send money and other things to people living here. Of course, supporting students, that's very, very frequent, happens a lot. But going back to the point you making and the relationship between Puerto Rico with this transnational thing that everybody knows that I am very critical of the transnational perspective. But there is, you know, that I've seen a constant flow of things from there to here in the format that you describe. It's, you know, it's very unlikely that a Puerto Rican will come from there con la mano vacía to visit a family member here. So I wonder, to what point, you know, the borders that you speak and that I see so vividly here in the cultural manifestations of Puerto Rico that are so rooted and so, you know, whether it from there to here rather than so much from here to there, as you can see with the other countries, so that perhaps there's something there going on. You know, it's not necessarily, you know.
One last thing. The other remittances that go on, for instance, with Cuba, are people that want to become santeros and palo and other sorts of religions. They have to go to Cuba to get, you know, certain kinds of artifacts. And that's a tremendous, tremendous exchange.
If you could talk about briefly the reverse migration that you said has decreased in Puerto Rico. And, you know, and if your own thoughts, if statehood became a reality for Puerto Rico, do you see your data changing to allow reverse migration to increase?
You know, the second question, I don't know if I have an answer for. I mean, I could tell you my
impression.
But let me try to answer the first one. I'm not sure that reverse migration has decreased. I think it has leveled off, especially after 2006. Some of the numbers that I didn't show here, but I have another presentation, suggest that people are still going back, not in the large number that they were before the crisis. But
5-1.
Yeah, something like that. I mean, in other words, when we talk about net migration from Puerto Rico, we still have to consider that a large number of people do go back, and therefore decrease the total number of people. You know, after you take account, subtract those who return, then the net migration is the result of that. So people are still moving and circulating. I think that's the point. Perhaps not as much as before because Puerto Rico is not an attractive place any longer for economic reasons, but it's still very strong for cultural reasons and family reasons and emotions. People do want to go back, and many do, in fact, return. So that would be my thought on that. But for example, the last census found that there are now around 250,000 people born in the U.S. living in Puerto Rico. And if you perhaps take off 30,000 who may not be Puerto Ricans, who may be Americans who, you know, stayed in Rincon and other places, former hippies and so on that are living there, most of those will be returned migrants and their children, right? So that's a lot of people. That's a quarter of a million people. And in fact, probably more, because then you wouldn't, that number doesn't include the people who were born in Puerto Rico, came to the United States, and went back. So a lot of people who have had experience migrating in the United States for different periods of time and have returned. And just to mention one situation that I know is an urgent concern, how do you teach these children who go back in public schools that are thought for, you know, conceived for Spanish speakers? And here you have, you know, bilinguals or perhaps even English speakers only who are not really taken care of. There are small programs here and there, but that's a big issue for those schools. The impact of slavery, I think, is hard to measure. I know Edwin, for example, a few years ago participated in a study trying to figure out forecast, and I don't know if you can do that. Of course, you have to revise it every time something happens. I don't think it would have a definitive impact, but because people can go back now. There are no barriers as of now to movement between the U.S. And Puerto Rico. I think it would have to do with whether economic conditions improve or not, and there's a lot of discussion about economics for that reason. When Edwin and the group did that study, they were still 936, right? The Section 936, which is now no longer in existence. So, and in fact, much of the recession has been due to this massive exodus of manufacturing employment, and that has clearly increased migration from Puerto Rico to the United States. So it's hard to tell. I mean, I can't really give you a definitive answer for that.
Thank you all very much for.